meow.
I'll be happy if I shoot my band. Yeah, that was the Feens. Feens. Broadcasting from Pod Bay 2A, a mile above sea level at Intergalactic Prairie Studios. And yes, I took out the trash tonight and had to go to the Star Wars type trash compactor and had to bring a whole bunch of tumbleweeds that I found. This is a tumbleweed powered radio show. And we alter your locus coeruleus by warming your synapses with rejuvenative radio waves. This keeps a sin flood of statism out of your brain. Can you feel it? Is it working? Is it working, Megan?
Yes.
And Diana? Is it working? Can you feel
it? Yes.
So
the spirit,
warm.
The spirit is coming through.
So warm and fuzzy.
Say it, Diana. Put your hands on the radio.
Put your hands on the radio and let the spirit of the Feens just come flowing right through you.
Yep. It's Preach. Flowing. It's flowing. Preach it, sister.
Amen.
Yeah. All right. So, Sister Diana.
Hallelujah.
Okay. Let's flip a coin here to see who. I'm going to flip a coin here. Let's see. Okay. MK, you want heads or tails? It's to see who
tails.
Reads. See who reads
tails
this thing.
Never fails.
Okay. Here we go. Ding. All right. It's MK. You want to read this thing? This is a friend of ours is trying to raise money for her mother who was messed with by the police. It's our friend Nicole, good friend of the Feens in person. One of our many photographers and a good friend from Porkfest. If you go to GoFundMe, that's GoFundMe.com/pleasehelpDonna. Please help D-O-N-N-A. This is about Nicole's mother. Will you please go ahead and read this?
Oh, I know Nicole.
MK?
Yeah. Yeah. So here's a story. This is by Nicole LaRouche. She says, my stepmother, Donna Merritt, was in a terrible accident on November 7th in which she swerved to avoid a deer and ended up going down a hill and into a creek. She had to be mercy flighted to the hospital. But before she got in the helicopter, the police wanted her to sign a consent form so they could draw blood and check for alcohol. She had not drank in 3 years and just wanted to get the help she needed, so she went along with it. The tox screen came back completely clean, but since the DA, Richard Healy, in Wayne County, presumed that this accident was alcohol-related, and because the paramedic said he thought he smelled alcohol, he was going to have her processed as such. So on November 26th, she was coerced into finding a ride to the Macedon police station so they could process her. If she didn't willingly go there, they threatened to send someone to go to the house and arrest her and add another false charge of resisting arrest. So her court date is December 30th, and she needs a lawyer. So this is to raise money for attorney fees. She's speaking with a civil rights attorney right now, and his fee is $2,500, which she does not have because she is disabled, as is Nicole's father. And Nicole says she's doing the best she can to continue to care for him despite the injuries she received in the accident. She's had a lot. She's having to have surgery to reconstruct her nose after it was broken. And I mean, falling down a hill.
Oh,
you know, this is a terrible situation. And the insurance company is not going to cover the vehicle because they didn't see any evidence of a deer, even though the car went down a hill and sat in the water for a couple hours. I mean, this is just a terrible situation that's made even worse by the police trying to charge her for something that she didn't actually do.
Yeah, and the Nicole said that the paramedics thinking they smelled wine was because she had a vinaigrette salad in the car, and when they went down the gulch, when she went down the gulch, it went all over the car, so the car smelled like vinaigrette, which kind of smells like wine. This is your tax dollars at work. This is your police in New York State protecting. This is what they call protecting people. Senior citizen who is disabled, who is taking care of her disabled husband, injures herself horribly and ends up getting apparently falsely arrested and, coerced. Like, it sounded like they wouldn't fly her to the hospital until she signed some piece of paper. So this is the police state in action. Nicole's a good friend of ours, and I believe everything she says, and people should go donate money to this. And again, the website is GoFundMe.com/pleasehelpDonna. And I'm going to be reading that again. It's not the last time I'm going to read this. So go fund Donna. Please help Donna at GoFundMe.com. So the topic tonight, and this is going to be a two-parter at least,
The name of the show tonight is Those Who Do Not Remember the Past Are Condemned to Repeat It. And don't drink the Kool-Aid, man.
Don't do it.
No, don't do it.
Yep. And so, that's it. Good night, everyone.
Good night. Yeah. So Those Who Do Not Remember the Past Are Condemned to Repeat It is a paraphrasing of a quote by George Santayana. The original is Those Who Cannot Remember the Past Are Condemned to Read It. It's very wise words. You know, some people have actually told me they thought this was a Bible quote. People don't know the Bible. They're like, no. Oh, it sounds wise and old timey. It must be the Bible. No, it's George Santayana, a poet. Now, where this plays into what we're talking about tonight is, that phrase, those who do not remember the past are condemned to repeat it, was hand painted on a board, on a placard, above the simple wooden throne of the madman cult leader Jim Jones in Guyana. I don't know if everybody remembers this or not. It was in 1978. This guy had started a church. It was an integrated church. It was a progressive church. It was a Marxist church. One out of three ain't bad. I like the integration part. I like the part that he didn't judge people by the color of their skin, and that he was concerned with social justice, which, you know, most of the things that are behind the phrase social justice are good fights to fight, you know, anti-racism, right. Anti-poverty, anti-imperialism, things like that. But a lot of these people end up wrapping it in Marxism, like Jim Jones did, and, you know, it turns into genocide. You don't have to be right. Mao Zedong or Stalin, as MK said, to turn Marxism into genocide. It can even happen on a small scale of 900 people and about 300 of them being children. So they moved down. They were getting a lot of, they were in San Francisco. They had this thing called the People's Temple. Talk about Marxism, man, the People's Temple. and he had a lot of political power. He was on the city, the mayor, Moscone, appointed him to the city council on the housing board. And politicians loved him. Ralph Nader loved him. Jerry Brown loved him. Moscone loved him. Harvey Milk loved him.
Harvey Milk really loved him, like defended him to the end almost.
Yeah, yeah. But he was getting a lot of heat from the press. They were calling him a cult. They were saying he wasn't letting people have free will. He was getting everyone to sign over their property. Mm-hmm. And
there's allegations of abuse, sexual abuse, all kinds of stuff.
He was getting so much heat that he left the country. He tried to make a libertarian paradise in Chile. No, I'm sorry. That's a different plan. He tried to make a socialist paradise in Guyana, which is the only English-speaking country in South America. And he bribed the local officials to not only allow an immigration of 900 people to be, you know, greenlit without a lot of paperwork. He also bribed the local officials to not allow those people to leave if they tried to. And, you know, so this kind of stuff can't happen as easily without the state, without governments.
Right.
And he, you know, built this agricultural compound, commune, you know, kind of like a little mini Maoist society down there. And had he was the unspoken leader. You know, he got on a bullhorn all hours of the day and night, woke people up, inserted their thoughts and his thoughts into their head, brainwashed them, scared them, wouldn't let them sleep when they wanted to sleep. Did a lot of kind of mind control stuff. You know, sort of like what they do in the military or the boarding school I was in. And the church farm school. And that was the name of it. Yeah. And this thing was in the middle of nowhere, man. It was like literally if you could leave, you know, if you could sneak out in the middle of the night and make it to the jungle. I mean, the nearest phone was like 50 miles or the nearest, you know, the nearest road was like 5 miles. The nearest, you know, phone, like civilization was like a 2-hour, 3-hour drive through the jungle. You could not escape from this thing. So
I'm still not sure how the survivors got out.
Some of them ran into the jungle. One lady was hiding under the, under a bed and heard the whole thing. And some other people, you know, were kind of the last ones standing, you know, with the machine guns and they didn't die. The thing was not a mass suicide. It was a mass murder. There were a few inner circle people who drank the Kool-Aid, drank the whatever the grape drink was, Kool-Aid like drink with cyanide and sleeping pills and a whole bunch of other stuff in it. And And they, you know, they forced it on children. They forced it on adults that didn't want to take it. They shot some people that didn't want to take it. Jim Jones was found dead with a bullet hole in his head. This was huge national news when Dianna and I were 14. And this is before MK Lourdes was born. But
I was 13, actually.
Okay, I was 14. I remember it, man. It was huge news. And
yeah,
it was even bigger news because a U.S. congressman got killed going down there to try to rescue those people. And he's the only sitting congressman who's ever been assassinated in the United States history. And I don't generally like politicians, but this guy was kind of a brave guy. Let's talk a little bit about him. What was his name?
His name was Leo Ryan. He started off as an assemblyman in California. And he did some pretty amazing things for a politician. He actually got out there and researched things on his own. He went and became a substitute teacher in order to investigate conditions after the Watts riots in LA in 1965. And then he was concerned about conditions in prisons in California. So he actually had himself put in prison, in Folsom Prison, actually, under a pseudonym so that he could investigate. And just imagine, you're a free person and you willingly go into this environment in order to improve conditions there. So based on that, he sounds like somebody that actually cared about his constituents.
Well, and he went down at their behest. He had a lot of people contacting him saying, I have family members down there. I think they're being held against their will. Could you please go down there and check this out? For people who say politicians are supposed to be working for us, mm-hmm. I mean, this is a good example of that. He listened to his constituents. He went down there to investigate it for himself.
And he was advised not to do it. Yeah. People told him it was dangerous, and he did it anyway,
Yeah. And this is around the same time that little after that, there was a congressman from Texas that was, basically creating Al Qaeda or was it the Taliban? Which one was it? What did the Mujahideen turn into?
Al Qaeda.
Yeah, he was funding the Mujahideen to fight Russia. Different guy, different congressman. What was that guy's name? You guys remember him?
In Texas?
There's people screaming at the radio right now. You don't know the name. We'll look it up. Yeah.
Charlie something.
Yeah. Charlie from Texas.
Y'all don't know him.
We'll be back.
Wax.
Charlie Wilson.
You're listening to Freedom Fiends. Go to freedomfiends.com to help keep it drone-proof.
When you shop online, please do it through the Freedom Fiends Amazon link over on the right side of freedomfiends.com. It won't cost you any extra, and the Fiends will get a little taste from Amazon, and Amazon will save you the danger of drive-by stabbings at your local mall. Amazon sells pretty much everything you can buy on this earth, except for guns and weed. But they do sell the DVD Guns and Weed, The Road to Freedom. So get that for your gun-hating stoner brother or neocon gun nut dad. They'll thank you for it. That's freedomfiends.com. Freedom, Foxtrot, Echo, Echo, November, Sierra.com.
So, MK Lourdes dropped some mad scientists in our lap during the break. And I was like, why aren't you saying that on the radio? So, go.
Okay. So, we were talking about this Congressman Ryan who went down to Guyana, and he was
not the current Congressman Ryan, not the Tea Party guy.
No, not him. Leo Ryan.
He's dead. He was killed by cult members of the Jim Jones cult.
Right. So what he was known for before he went down there was he was a huge vocal critic of the lack of congressional oversight of the Central Intelligence Agency. And he authored the Hughes-Ryan Amendment, which would have required extensive CIA notification of Congress about planned covert operations. Now, I find this part interesting. Congressman Ryan once told Dick Cheney that leaking a state secret was an appropriate way for a member of Congress to block an ill-conceived operation.
Now, did he say...
So this is 70s Dick Cheney, who, by the way, is not very much different from 2000s Dick Cheney.
Now, right. Do you think that got him killed? I mean, there is a theory that the CIA had something to do with Jonestown. I didn't know that he had enemies in high places.
Well, yeah. So Dick Cheney's interesting. If any of the listeners are familiar with the book Dirty Wars by Jeremy Scahill, which was made into a documentary. Yeah.
Good documentary.
Made into a documentary. Very excellent, excellent book, too. It goes into the details. It goes all the way back to this time period, the late 70s, where you had people like Dick Cheney, Donald Rumsfeld, basically the main players of the Bush administration, very hawkish back
then. The axis
of evil. The
axis
of evil, like these people were still, they were wanting to close off the CIA to Congress. They were wanting to keep state secrets, do these covert operations without having to notify Congress or the American people, things like that. They've been at this for a while, and Dirty Wars goes all the way back, analyzing their moves back then. They were wanting to go back into Afghanistan.
Kind of the beginning of the neocon movement, like the movement of Republicans away from being fiscally conservative and what the Democrats like to call isolationist, but actually it's non-interventionist of
like Eisenhower was.
Not wanting to be empire builders. And, you know, basically the whole Fox News thing and the, you know, starting with Nixon, kind of like turning the Republican Party into, you know, the cranky version of the Democrat Party.
Right. So you had a lot of opposition to this kind of mindset in the late 70s, because the time period you're coming out of Vietnam, people are still very anti-war. So they didn't get a lot of leeway. They were actually rejected by a lot of members of Congress. Ryan was one of these congressmen who was very adamantly opposed to these hawks. And they were kind of pushed out because they were considered completely fringe, crazy people. So when they came back, under the Bush administration, there are quotes from people in Congress saying, seriously, they let the crazies back in? They call them the crazies. Like Rumsfeld,
they do that now. They do that now about the Tea Party. But those people,
but these were
the
old school Republicans saying this. These were the people who were Republicans in the 70s who remember Dick Cheney.
Wasn't Dick Cheney old in the 70s?
Yes.
I mean, he looked old.
I don't think he doesn't age past a certain point. I think he's like part bionic.
He always looks like Mr. Burns.
I got to be careful, man. I'm in Wyoming. He runs this. He could. I'm not talking. I'm just sitting here, man. Go ahead.
Right. So this is interesting. This congressman was known for this, and he was really wanting to open up the CIA's operations to people, which people think of the CIA as this agency who collects a lot of information about foreign governments. But what they've really been doing in the past several decades is staging coups and overthrowing these governments without congressional approval.
The United States loves to spread democracy around the world unless it doesn't serve their purposes. I mean, going back to Iran and before that, people democratically elect a leader in their own country and the United States say, no, we like the tyrant better. We're going to put the tyrant in.
Yeah. Did that with the Shah, did that with Saddam Hussein.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. All over.
I mean, there's a whole, the Wikipedia is actually a kind of a good source for all of the CIA coups. You could just type in CIA covert coups. I mean, it's a whole list. You'd be amazed at how many countries.
And that's just the ones
we know
about.
Right. That's just the ones that have been, declassified. So, and it's important to note that someone like Jim Jones was really playing off of this kind of social justice, anti-war activism that was going on at the time, too.
Well, it goes to that thing that you've said that, I've heard you say before that, you used to be a Democrat because you thought Republicans were bad and you thought Democrats were the opposite, so they must be good, which is a common fallacy. And I think that, capitalism is so co-opted to corporatism and fascism in the United States, to where the government is picking winners and losers and crushing people, through the banksters, that simple people who don't know of options like, anarcho-capitalism and voluntarism look at that as capitalism's communism must be good. It's a childlike attitude, but people buy it. People are still buying it.
You're listening to Freedom Fiends. So much truth, it hurts.
Are you tired of your taxes funding endless occupations around the world? Antiwar.com is run by people who understand that wars abroad become wars at home, wars on our freedoms. Antiwar.com is dedicated to bringing you the latest in news, views, interviews, and reviews from the top movers and shakers in the anti-occupation movement. Antiwar.com has it all, from thorough foreign policy analysis to interviews with whistleblowers who used to run the military-industrial complex. Anti-war, pro-free market. That's antiwar.com.
is Michael Dean Freedom Fiends, talking to Dianna Keiler, the Laughing Kitty, and Megan Lords, the Wolfram Panther. And I think that means the Tungsten Panther, right?
Yes.
Yeah. So you're going to drop some more mad science on us, and we're just going to sit here in awe at your feet going, man, history's cool. So go ahead.
Yeah. History is super cool. And this kind of goes into the saying, if you don't learn from history, you're bound to repeat it. So yeah. Go all the way back. Like, look at this, look at the players who have been involved in Congress, involved in politics and the CIA, going all the way back, because this all plays into what's happening right now as far as the wars, the drone wars, the covert. There's a bunch of covert operations. There's some that we kind of know about, but a lot that we still don't know about, because the CIA has never been held to any kind of accountability. And these are the same government agencies. You go back to the late 60s. We watched the Black Power mixtape this weekend, and it goes into how these agencies, especially the FBI and CIA, infiltrated these effective, tactically effective movements to kill their leaders, to suppress the movement. I mean, they did all kinds of things. One of the tactics was called bad jacketing, which was used on Stokely Carmichael, who was the founder of SNCC. SNCC. And this basically involves slandering people as an agent provocateur, saying you're you know, a government agent, basically trying to ruin someone's credibility. And this
I think that was done recently with, there was a guy from, they don't want to kill people because I don't think they kill people unless the people are absolutely going to drop a bunch of information that they have proof of, and they can kill the person in a way that doesn't make them a martyr, or they wait until you're not effective anymore and they kill you, like, you know, they probably did with John Lennon, and they probably did with Amiri Baraka, you know, to where you're past the point of your peak of popularity where you'll become a martyr if you're murdered. But you know, I think that happened recently, the discrediting the false flags with the guy from the Oath Keepers. There's a guy from the Oath Keepers who was pretty high up in that organization, who was accused by his ex of molesting their child, and, you know, she was being goaded by some district attorney, and it really looked like a targeting. And that's the dirtiest thing they can drop on anybody, is say, you know, they're a child molester, or they have kiddie porn or something. And that's the kind of thing where, like, they don't even have to prove it. They just have to say it, you know?
Well, and it depends on who you are, too. If you're a prominent figure in entertainment, you can have these things thrown at you. And, you know, maybe it doesn't matter so much, you know?
Yeah,
people actually defend it. I mean, you know,
or they get away with it. I mean,
or they just,
you know, Roman Polanski literally drugged and raped a 13-year-old girl, got away with it. Who else? Let's see. The rapper. Who's the rapper? The singer?
R. Kelly?
Yeah, R. Kelly.
Yeah, R. Kelly. Yeah.
He got away with it. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. People like their entertainers to do that. They don't like their political leaders to do that. And
Sports ball players.
They're sports ball. The sports ball players. I want to interject here real quick before you go back to the mad scientists. I have been on this tear recently of saying, you know, you shouldn't elevate people, especially in the liberty movement, to the position of leaders, to where they're unquestioned, to where really, to where, like, I don't even think there should be 5 people everyone's paying attention to. I think there should be 50 people everyone's paying attention to, and then
that's
making
right.
their own media. And yeah. I've been accused of being like, oh, you're just jealous. No, man, I have a pretty big audience. We have a big audience. We're on, you know, 34 radio stations. You know, we get hits on the torrents. We get hits on the website. You know, and it's not like people measure by Alexa rankings. That just measures how many hits you get on your website. But most people on a podcast site, like, we're not a social network site, the Freedom Fiends. People go to the site once because they hear it. They subscribe on their podcatcher, and then they don't go back. And that doesn't even show up on Alexa rankings. And Alexa rankings can be, like, totally faked by getting, like, 10 people to add the Alexa toolbar. But
speaking of audience, don't we now have somebody listening from Dubai? Or didn't we? trip there.
Yeah, you have spread the word of the Fiends to Dubai. We have 2 people regularly listening from Dubai.
It concerns me now a little bit.
It's probably the government spying on you. It's probably the CIA in Dubai. So who knows? But the thing I'm really beginning at is, like, if you want a movement that can succeed, you don't want leaders, because leaders get taken out and it kills the movement. That was another thing that the 60s leaders in the youth movements, all, you know, SDS, the Yippies, the Black Panthers, the Black Power movement, you know, Martin Luther King, the Civil Rights movement. That's another thing they all did wrong, was allowed leaders to become rock stars who were unquestioned and like deified. Those kind of people, when they're taken out, it kills the movement. You want a leaderless movement. You know, I'm not even saying like cells capable of operating without central command. I'm talking about just like down to the last man, like every person being their own movement, you know?
Yeah, you know, I think I saw something in the Black Power mixtape about...
That's a movie, by the way.
Yeah, there was one really brief thing about how there was one particular part of the movement where they wanted to not focus so much on individual leaders. And I don't remember exactly what part of the movement that was, but I thought that was interesting.
People are sheep. They want leaders. That's
yeah,
a problem.
They want, yeah, well, that's there, unfortunate. There was, yeah.
There was a lot of debate about that with, you know, within these different Black liberation groups, whether it was a Black Liberation Army or Black Panthers or even Nation of Islam. There were a lot of different power struggles. I mean, one of the reasons Malcolm X left Nation of Islam was he discovered that the prophet Elijah Muhammad was a philanderer and was doing all of these unethical things. And he became really disillusioned. And you saw him towards the end of his life moving away from that.
Every leader in every movement is shearing the shot, the flock, man, to make it radio friendly. Mm-hmm. You know, I have never met a leader that doesn't take advantage of the groupie situation, whether they're male or female. They're all doing it, and they're doing it generally in a kind of dirty way, too.
Right.
You know?
Yeah, right? It's true. It's part of their mind control.
Well, they don't make any money. They have to get something out of it. You know, it's people that are like power hungry. And, you know, generally the people that become leaders are people that have, you know, low self-esteem and a huge ego and are charismatic and eloquent. And those people become, you know, even without trying sometimes, but especially with trying. Yeah, I think an example of someone who became that person without trying is Kurt Cobain. I mean, he really didn't like the spotlight. He was nervous about it. He had this punk rock ethic of like, you know, kill rock stars kind of thing. And he became a rock star and he had to kill himself because he believed kill rock stars, man. So, the people that are attracted to that moth light are the people that are generally the most damaged. So you shouldn't follow him anyway. You shouldn't follow anybody.
Well, and the ones who are attracted to it are the ones most likely to fall into those traps. Power recognizes power, and the power structure is going to attack effective leaders. An effective leader is someone who people want to follow without them forcing leadership upon them. You know, one of the reasons they targeted Stokely Carmichael is because he would give these extremely eloquent speeches, and the way he would talk to the media was so calm and cool and collected.
Yeah.
What he was saying was radical. He really was. He didn't need to act crazy and, you know, like a, you know, arms flailing. What he was saying was impactful, and it was meaningful, and it was very, very jarring. And he was specifically targeted because of his effectiveness. And there's this really good story by Talib Kweli in Black Power Mixtape, where he says he was watching Stokely Carmichael videos for a few months right after 9/11, and he had booked a flight, and he gets to the airport, and the TSA detains him. Yeah. There's like CIA, FBI, and they're interrogating him for hours about watching these videos from, you know, 40-something years ago. Right. And he was saying, you know, there are rappers who rap about killing people every single day, but they don't get detained, you know, by the FBI.
Because they're talking about killing other Black people. They're not talking about empowering Black people.
Right, right. So I mean, that just goes to show you how effective Stokely was.
You know what? I think Obama studied Stokely to learn to speak like him. He kind of does.
He does have that calm demeanor. He's very good at rhetoric, which is something that you see in a lot of good leaders have very good rhetoric also.
And rhetoric like has Malcolm nothing X. to do with content. It can exist outside of content, you know, like libertarian philosophers who don't even know philosophy but are really good at rhetoric. And the thing that you always get when you criticize these people rightly is they're minions saying, well, he'll debate you. You should debate him, because these are people who've studied debate since they were in eighth grade and they're really good at it. And that has nothing to do with truth. You know, a common thing they teach in debate class is pick something you are absolutely against and debate for it. That's a really common exercise in debate. Mm-hmm. You know, pick something that's completely false to you and make a case for it.
a good attorney can argue both sides effectively.
Yeah.
For real.
Yeah.
And absolutely. You know, politicians are excellent at rhetoric, and politicians are all snakes. So being good at rhetoric doesn't prove you're a good person or have good ideas.
Right, right. It's an effective tool for controlling people or for getting people to follow you in a lot of ways. It's important to understand how it works and understand the ways in which people who want to be leaders, exploitative leaders, use it to control people. Because studying language, you can really see and understand how they manipulate things, how they use things like reverse psychology to sell you a point that they're trying to make without explicitly selling it to you. It's right. A lot of it is very implicit as opposed to explicit, and you don't even really notice it, especially if you've kind of been desensitized to it or you're just kind of passively listening.
Yeah,
it's
and
good
you
to
know,
analyze the language being used.
We've said on here before that patriotism taken to the ultimate extreme leads to North Korea or Nazi Germany, and that's absolutely true. You know, when you say my country right or wrong, and you're willing to die for your country no matter what your country is standing for that week, it leads to North Korea or Nazi Germany. And I would say that having leaders when taken to the extreme leads to, you know, the Jonestown massacre.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah, definitely. It's good to protect yourself. By studying language, you can protect and defend yourself against dangerous rhetoric that's used to manipulate people. And people do it on a small scale without even realizing it too. That's why even with libertarianism, I don't see it as being something that is infiltrated probably as much as libertarians think it is, because I don't see it reaching that kind of level of effectiveness that you saw in the civil rights movement. In some ways it's effective, but I don't really see a lot of infiltration because there's already enough kind of strange leader culty like personalities who seem to rise to the top and try to control people, control certain, it's an ideological kind of thing, and people fall for that too. And you don't even have to have government agents coming in, infiltrating and putting that out there.
Yeah. I mean,
libertarianism, people who naturally rise to power have these attributes.
Libertarianism is basically shooting itself in the foot at this point, because the people that are the leaders are so flawed. You know, the five or six of them are so flawed that how could anybody take any of them seriously, really? And really, having a leader is counterintuitive to libertarianism. You should not have leaders, man.
That's right.
Listen to me, brothers and sisters. Do not have leaders.
You're listening to the Freedom Fiends, and I'm beaming these words into your cerebellum.
Having outgrown childish libertarian fantasies, I now believe in worms! What is Libertarians Against Humanity? It's the only unofficial Cards Against Humanity expansion pack by libertarians, for libertarians, and against libertarians. Libertarians Against Humanity is free to play online, or join the Indiegogo campaign to get physical copies and other perks to play with friends or statists you haven't defued yet. Because if we don't laugh, the statists win.
Not recommended for faint heart, thin skins, or those who easily rustle jimmies. Consult a physician if you experience dropping blood pressure or laughter lasts longer than 4 hours.
That's libertariansagainsthumanity.com.
Now that the elections are over and liberty has slipped even further away, it's time to try yet another political organization. Campaign for a Longer Leash is a nonpartisan group of pups and dogs dedicated to fighting for longer leashes for all. We're not talking about no leashes, that would be catarchy. We just want the limited leash that the Founding Fathers promised us. As Bone Barklin once said, a longer leash if you can keep it, ma'am. For more info, go to facebook.com/campaignforalongerleash.
Freedom Fiends, lay your hands on the radio, brothers and sisters, and hear the truth.
Feel it.
My name's not important. Only the message is important. That's my new favorite line. I'm Michael Dean. That's a line from the movie The Time Machine, the 1960 movie, when the guy goes way into the future and discovers that, you know, basically the government has turned into these underground people who farm these docile, dependent people, kind of like the government does now, but more
extreme. Eloy.
Yeah. Eloy. And the only history they have are these like discs that you spin and they play recordings of people. And one of them is a guy talking about, you know, how the Great War that lasted 375 years destroyed everything. And he starts with saying, "Hello, my name is not important.
only my message is important.
Mm-hmm. Well, you know, we've got a good start because we've pretty much been in one war after another for 100 years now.
I think there should be, if there's going to be a
they're all connected.
I got an idea. This is a teaching hospital and we tell people how to start radio shows and podcasts and how to do it right and give a lot of tech advice. I would say if somebody wants to start a really cool, weird Liberty podcast and be a weird Liberty leader, I think the coolest way you could do that is by being anonymous. Like actually start every show with, hello, my name is not important, only my message is. And like, don't let anyone know who you are. I think you'd have a better chance at becoming popular. So we've been warning against having leaders and talking about the problems of leaders and how they're all messed up and how they can be taken out. They are single points of failure. We're tending toward more a distributed network of talkers and activists and knowledge givers, not necessarily in one central location, not necessarily talking on one topic, not necessarily making one kind of media. But I also would encourage people to
diversify
your study of history. And by what I mean by that is most newly minted libertarians kind of live in this pond where, you know, basically they've read Mises. And, oh, by the way, Dianna did a new reading for Mises, a new audio pamphlet, 7-minute thing. How long is your thing, your new thing? What's it called?
It's a War Making and Class Conflict.
Who wrote it?
By Joseph Salerno.
Cool, man.
Yeah, it's really, really good, actually.
And that's,
I mean, I'm not saying that my rendition of it was good, but the article's very good.
Your stuff's good. And I'm not going to say I built that, but I did help you get a good mic and teach you how to record. And
You sure did.
I'm trying to spread it, man. I don't want to be the one guy speaking into a mic. I want to teach, like, you know, 100 other people how to do it well. So the other thing I'd recommend is there's a lot of history to study other than what a lot of libertarians do, which is, you know, a lot of libertarians just study, you know, Mises, and then like they follow two or three, you know, people making YouTube videos who have ego problems. So don't do that, man. Study a lot more than that. Study things that don't necessarily have to do with libertarianism, but happened, you know. I would say the most important American history to study is what's happened in my lifetime. And it's not important because it's my lifetime, but the last 50 years of American history are far more important to what's going on now than, you know, the almost 200 years before that. So, you know, study the fall of the Berlin Wall, study the Cold War, study the youth movements of the 60s, the Black Panthers, the SDS, the Yippies, the civil rights movement, you know, the marches in Alabama to get people to be able to vote. Study all that stuff and look at what they did right and what they did wrong. What they did right was they did a great job of amassing people to come out to do something. In a way, what did you say about MK, about libertarians?
So you look at how effective these people in the civil rights era were at rallying people, and you had million man marches, you had these giant coalitions forming together, you know, bringing massive amounts of people into the streets to protest. And I mean, it's hard for libertarians to even organize a conference and get a lot of people. I mean, that's not a knock, it's just, you
it's
know
true.
It's difficult. I've been on both sides
it's like
of this
herding
too,
cats
so.
Man,
it's very difficult to organize a conference. And, you know, what you said earlier about studying history is so important, because a lot of time libertarians get into this kind of echo chamber. They get into this mindset of socialism bad. I'm not going to study any of it.
We
but
all
if
know
you
that.
Study the tactics, like look at these socialist groups, look at the tactics that they used. Mm-hmm. They don't want to, sometimes they don't want to admit that the left has been very effective from a tactical standpoint,
and not
even
just,
if the
and
message
not,
is wrong.
And not just the tactics of, like, you know, breaking people's heads in a union bus.
Right.
Union people, but also, you know, the non-coercive things they did of just to organize people. Community organizers, that's what Obama was in college, man, or you know, around that time, was a community organizer. There are no good libertarian community organizers, and there should be. And that doesn't even take leaders. Like, the community organizers are groups of people, like, you don't even know the names of who's doing it, you know?
Yeah.
Although the CIA knows the names of who's doing it.
Watch out, MK.
MK Ultra and MK Lords and myself, Michael Dean, and the man with no name, and Dianna Keiler will be back for hour two on the Freedom Fiends after this trip to the worms.
This show survives on donations from fiends like you. We put that money back into our show and Liberty Outreach, and donate most of our ad space to Liberty organizations that make a difference. We're also a teaching hospital, educating the next generation of Liberty Talkers on the skills needed to keep the radio flame of truth burning into the future. Put your money where your heart is and make a donation of any amount to the Freedom Fiends. Please go to freedomfiends.com and click on the spinning coin on any post.
My name is not important. My name is not important. Only what I say is important. And it's not important that I'm saying it. It's just important that it be said. And I'm talking to MK Lords.
Hallelujah.
And Dianna. Dianna Keiler and Megan Keiler. Free Eldridge Keiler. Now we're going to get into that. He's dead. He can't be freed. But He did give Timothy Leary a place to stay for a while when Timothy Leary broke out of jail. And we're talking about the Ute.
They tuned in and tuned out.
Yeah, we're talking about
turned on and tuned out, whatever it is.
The Ute movements of the 60s and 70s and what people can learn from them. You know, another thing I'd say that people in Liberty could learn from is going back and studying the birth of kind of pop culture advertising in the late 60s and early 70s. There's a few documentaries on it that escape my name on Netflix right now, but just search advertising documentary on Netflix. There's a few of them. It's pretty amazing the changes that happened then, and it's really worth studying now that everyone has access to worldwide media through their little chromed robot turd in their pocket, their little cell phone or whatever. You know, people did all this stuff without the internet. That's pretty amazing to me. People used to do phone trees. Do you know what phone trees are?
Yeah, I think.
What are
they? I remember what those are. I guess I don't really remember.
Okay, phone tree was a method for getting out information to large amounts of people before the internet. It was basically, you would have a list of people and each person would call five people on the list and each of them would call five people. And it was a way of like getting a message out to, you know, 10,000 people in a couple hours just using telephones. And that's what they did. That was one way they organized before the internet. I'm not saying go back to that. I'm saying think outside the box. I hate that term, but think that creatively for ways to organize and get an idea out. Don't just be like everyone else, go on YouTube and turn your camera on and talk into it and, you know, get a bunch of weirdos thinking, oh, you're cool because you're controversial and you're on YouTube. Man, no, if you want to be controversial, invent YouTube. Invent something better than YouTube.
Yeah. You don't have to be this kind of, you know, wildly flailing activist type, you know, attention seeking thing to make change. I mean, I know our culture kind of thinks that's something that is good now. You know, you can go viral with like a silly video or something like that. But you know, let's talk about like actual tactics and like freeing people. You know, you mentioned earlier Timothy Leary was broken out of jail by the Weather Underground. Another revolutionary that was broken out of jail was Assata Shakur of the Black Liberation Army. She was, you know, it's believed that she was falsely charged of the murder of a police officer, and the Black Liberation Army ended up breaking her out of jail. She's still down in Cuba. There's $1 million bounty on her head still. But she escaped and got away. And, you know, I don't know. You don't hear a lot of these tactics talked about among libertarians, at least I have, and I kind of hear more of the jury nullification arguments, which is a good form of activism, and I do support. But yeah, I mean, some of the stuff they were doing in the 60s, I mean, they were like, you know, let's not just raise funds for political prisoners, let's break them out.
And we're not saying
they were radical.
We're not
then.
Saying let's break people out of prison, but that's not discussed. I don't know if it'd be as easy as it was back then too. You know, part of the way that
it's much harder now,
part of the way that Timothy Leary was able to break out of jail was, he got himself put into the minimum security part of that jail. And the way he got himself put in there, do you know about this? They gave everybody, he was in, what's the one in California? He was in, same one Manson was in. What is that prison in San Francisco Bay? That one. Yeah. So he was in prison and they gave everyone that came into that prison a psychological evaluation and he gamed it to get put in the minimum security part. And the way he gamed it was he helped write that. He was one of the psychologists who was, so he knew the test and he knew the right answers to give to go into the right part of the jail to be able to be broken out.
Wow.
But he ended up going to Algeria and kind of almost being Eldridge Cleaver's like slave or like prisoner. Silence.
Really?
it does say it. Well, Cleaver, I'm reading the article on it. Cleaver placed Leary under, quote, revolutionary arrest as a counter-revolutionary for promoting drug use. Yeah. So, and this became problematic. This field, the thing is, people started to become extremely paranoid during this time, too, because there was so much government infiltration that everyone became paranoid of everyone else. You know, now you're a counter-revolutionary. You're trying to, you know, you're trying to destabilize the movement by promoting drug use. And that could be seen as something that was very serious, especially later on in the 70s when you have the heroin epidemics in the ghettos and then the crack epidemics in the 80s too, which a lot of people believe the government was involved in perpetuating, or, you know, they had plants that were in there, you know, promoting these things. And what it did is it ultimately did destabilize a lot of the energy that was behind these movements.
Yeah. And, you know, I mean, what do libertarians have that they can point out? Like, you know, a couple articles in Reason magazine and, you know, got made fun of on the Colbert Report. And I'm not saying that I'm not of the camp of that. I don't believe that the Colbert Report making fun of the people putting nickels in parking meters and yelling at meter maids. I don't think that set liberty back. I think it moved it forward about an 18th of an inch. Maybe, but
I don't think it did anything.
But the thing, but the thing, it was funny as heck, though, too. But
it was funny, though.
The thing, I mean, funny. Like, that's considered a major coup or a major problem to most libertarians. Like, that's a big thing to them. Being on the Colbert Report, I mean, that's like, that's cable. It's at night. You know, it's a bunch of stone teenagers watching it. I mean, these 60s youth leaders, I mean, they were like interviewed on NBC, watched by everyone in America, primetime news by Walter Cronkite. That's the thing to look for, you know?
Yeah, and I mean, you can look at the government documents on this. People like LBJ and people like Herbert Hoover, you know, even coming out and saying, "I'm sorry, did I get that wrong?" He's coming out and saying these people are a threat. They specifically need to be targeted. Yeah. I mean, someone like Fred Hampton, who was incredibly young when he was assassinated, 21 years old. And he had stirred so much energy behind this movement, and he was specifically targeted. I mean, they shut down the whole block. I don't know. There's a good documentary out there about Fred Hampton. I really highly recommend looking into it. The way that when they did end up assassinating these people, and you saw this with the MOVE organization too, they just completely annihilated them. They would shut down the entire neighborhood and just
burn them to the ground.
Them to the ground.
I want to talk about MOVE. Hello, are you there? Hello,
I'm here.
Yeah,
let's talk about MOVE.
I'm reading about Timothy Leary.
Okay. And you know, the thing is with a lot of these Ute leaders from the 60s, a lot of what they got right was noticing that things are wrong. And a lot of what they did wrong was a combination of like Marxism, collectivism, wanting to work with the government in some situations, advocating for open collectivized violence, you know, against groups of people, and really just kind of, and you know, then of course, like heroin just completely kills the revolutionary spirit. You know, somebody on heroin, if they can't get it, they need to be out like robbing people to get it because it's illegal. If they can get it, they just want to sit in the corner and listen to jazz music, man. They don't want to go out and be radical. And, you know, then later crack, which, you know, a lot of people think the CIA had a lot to do with both of those things to bring down the Ute movement. and, you know, like Timothy Leary had a lot of good things to say, but he almost got it right. But he wasn't, he wanted to like change the government to make it, you know, equitable. And that's not how you do it, because governments will never be equitable. They will always crush people.
There's
always going to be a ruling class always, as long as there's a government.
Yeah.
So we want to
talk about MOVE, this organization in Philadelphia. Now, I went to boarding school at the Church Farm School in Paoli, Pennsylvania, right near Lancaster, Pennsylvania, from 1978 to 1982. And
when in 1978, because I was actually living in Lititz for the summer during 1978.
I don't know where that is, but
near Lancaster.
You know, it was like one third inner city black kids from Philly, and then like everybody else was white and from the rest of the country. And basically, to go to this school, there was one criteria: it was you had to be from a broken family or be the kid of military. No, it wasn't military of a clergy member. So basically, it was started by a guy from a broken family whose father was a clergy, and he wanted to make a school for kids like that because he thought they had, I don't know, special needs or something. So I was from a broken family, so I went to this school because I was kind of a handful, so they wanted to ship me off somewhere, and they did. And I met black kids from Philly who were talking about this thing called MOVE. And one kid claimed to like know them and be friends with them. And I don't know if he was just trying to scare the white kid or if he really did, but it kind of scared me. I mean, he was like, yeah, they don't bathe. They don't use running water. They don't have electricity. They grow their own food. They educate their own kids and they have lots of guns. And I was like, that sounds scary. You know, which I mean, basically, that also describes a lot of, you know, people like libertarians that want to live off the grid or small government people that want to live off the grid now. And if you want to study another thing from the 60s and 70s that is vastly influential on all of society today, but especially in some ways on the liberty movement and the small government, back to the land, prepper, gun type people growing their own organic food. Read the Whole Earth Catalog. Do you guys know what the Whole Earth Catalog is?
I've heard familiar
it,
with yeah.
it. It was kind of like Steve Jobs described it as Google on paper before Google. It was a book that was really big. You know, it was like, you know, two and a quarter feet by, you know, a foot and a half wide, and then like, you know, 4 inches thick. And it came out like
a phone book.
Like a phone book, big phone book. And it came out like once or twice a year. And it was basically all about tools for empowering people. And it was, you know, a lot of hippies read it, but it was like, it was about building geodistic domes. It was about living off the land. It was about, you know, making your own electricity. It was about running your own printing presses. It actually had things on computers, on personal computers, but I mean, on even before computers, they had things on like getting timeshare time at, you know, university computers to do things for helping people or helping yourself or creating a network of people. And it was the guy who started it, Stewart Brand, also started World Electronic Link, which was one of the first internet service providers, like years before AOL, you know, before the web. And there was stuff about computers in it. There was stuff about guns in this. And this was a book for hippies, but it was for hippies that were living on the land. And it, you know, told you what rifles to get and what shotguns to get and how to hunt and how to do home defense even. I mean, it was kind of the precursor to like, you know, the living off the land, own your own body armor, make your own ammo and grow your own vegetables movement. Whole Earth Catalog. We'll talk about MOVE when we get back.
You're listening to The Freedom Fiends, an invigorating alternative to those other shows.
Hey, this is Squiscar Squiggles from Death Clocks, and you are listening to the Freedoms Fiends on the, you know, the radios, and I guess I says worms now, so there you go.
You've read books, attended lectures, and you know the Constitution well enough to know it's a well-crafted blueprint to create an ever-increasing federal empire, but there's still one thing missing.
Buttons!
Freedom Fiends now has buttons. You'll get state speech is hate speech, guns and weed, buy sheep for sheep on sheep, and two designs for the Freedom Fiends. Wear them with pride. Use them to start conversations with statists.
It's only $10 for 10 buttons, including shipping.
Go to freedomfiends.com and click on the link at the top that says buttons.
What does freedom mean? Tune in to LRN.FM to find out. LRN.FM is the Liberty Radio Network, a collection of live talk radio and podcasts, all coming from a principled pro-liberty perspective. LRN.FM show hosts aren't left, right, or conspiracy kooks. You can tune in 24/7 to LRN.FM via your phone, computer, satellite, and more. Listen free anytime at LRN.FM. That's LRN.FM.
Do you believe in free speech? Jay Raven had her True Shives YouTube channel taken down. We believe this censorship was wrong, and we believe the channel is a clear example of free speech. Many people are bullied on the internet, but Jay Raven actually stood up to the bullying. She has filed a self-defense lawsuit against the individuals who took down the channel. The outcome of this suit could be very important to the future of free speech. Learn more at trueshibes.com. That's Tango, Romeo, Uniform, Sierra, Hotel, India, Bravo, Echo, Sierra.com. trueshibes.com.
I like how I was talking about the Whole Earth Catalog and how it's the missing link between the hippies and the gun people. And then we go to the break and then we hear an ad for body armor and an ad for organic heirloom seeds. That's what I'm talking about, yeah. Man. So we want to talk about MOVE, which was an organization started by John Africa in Philadelphia. And it caused a little bit of consternation. You want to, first of all, I just want to say, before we even say what it is, I want to say the police vastly overreacted, but these people were like the worst neighbors ever, and I don't blame their neighbors for haranguing the city to get rid of them.
Right. So MOVE was founded in 1972. They were originally called the Christian Movement for Life, and it was founded by a guy named John Africa, and everyone changed their surname to Africa. What they were, they were basically advocating this form of green politics, this return to hunter-gatherer, almost anarcho-primitivist. Yeah. You know, they lived in a commune together. They grew their own food. They were all vegans or vegetarians, composted. They were basically hippies with guns. And they were very vocal about their beliefs, too. They would get on bullhorns and denounce, you know, the institutionalized racism and the police and all of this stuff.
And you know, zoos.
They were very, you know, pro-animal rights. They considered it morally wrong to kill vermin with pest control. So that, you know,
they attracted to their yards with a garbage and human waste that they used as compost in their yards.
Yeah, the
yes.
I think the worst thing that they did as neighbors was they mounted a bullhorn outside their house and would just start screeching profanity against the system, including their neighbors, their black neighbors. You know, they were black and they were in a black neighborhood. They lived two different places in two different black, you know, lower middle class working neighborhoods. And they would just wake these people up in the middle of the night screaming tirades about, you know, you're all part of the effing system, like in the middle of the night, and wake them up. Worst neighbors ever.
Right. So they were really politically active in a lot of ways. They were very much pro self-defense and pro, you know, if you're shooting at us, we're going to shoot back. Well, this ended up one of the first conflicts I had is in 1978. The police tried to get them to vacate the premises. They were basically evicted from their home and they ignored it. They were like, this is our home. We're going to stay here. And the police came. And during the scuffle, a police officer was killed. And then they basically arrested 9 members and they were found guilty of third degree murder.
And here's the thing, like a lot of like white conservative people cheered that when it happened and cheered what happened later at the other house. Now, but those are a lot of those are the same people who like back what happened, you know, back the people at Ruby Ridge and say the government way overreacted, and back the people at Waco and say the government way overreacted. The government did way overreact at Waco. At Ruby Ridge, and you know, almost did at Bundy Ranch. But the thing about Bundy Ranch is it's not over. I mean, the militias are saying we won. They went away. No, they're going to drag that guy into court for 10 years, and that's already, you know, sort of happening. So they're going to drag him somewhere that only the government can have guns.
Yeah, the difference I think it could be that they were the right color, maybe.
Yeah, I mean, really, I mean, like what MOVE did. First of all, they were horrible neighbors, and you know, the Ruby Ridge didn't really have neighbors, and the Waco compound didn't really have neighbors to speak of. But I mean, this was like inner city Philly, like houses next door. But aside from that, like they basically did what most, you know, white patriot gun small government, we got to get back to the republic kind of types would do if the government came in and took a bulldozer to the side of your house, which is what happened, you know.
Right.
Yeah. I mean, so it gets really crazy. The MOVE organization, they arrested 9 of the people. The 9 of them were found guilty. And I mean, they're still in jail right now, actually.
And they're not necessarily people who shot at the police.
These are not. Yeah, they I mean, it was very hard to tell what happened in this situation. There were several people who were injured, including MOVE members.
Arrest them all. Arrest them all and let the courts sort it out. That's what people think. Yeah.
Right, right. So they end up moving out of that house and still having, you know, still having problems. The cops were still, you know,
well, that
monitoring
house,
their activities. And they you know, still doing the same things. But basically, they closed off the neighborhood and specifically targeted the house. They started lobbing tear
You're
gas canisters.
You talking about the first house or the second house?
This is the second
house. Okay, the first house, to be clear, the first house was kind of in a residential neighborhood. I mean, kind of an industrial, mixed neighborhood of industrial and residential. Like, they had some room between their neighbors. Then they moved to a house, like a row house, where their house is connected to other houses in a totally working class, you know, black, lower middle class neighborhood, where, like, kids go to school, people wake up and go to work. And we'll be back with that chapter after this trip to the market.
Freedom Fiends with Michael Dean. This is what radio sounds like now.
Shiny badges on your jacket. Shiny badges.
This is Davi Barker from shinybadges.com, and I just want to personally apologize for airing a jingle week after week, month after month, that turned out to be such an infectious brain worm. So to make it up to you, I'm offering a free gift. The next time you make a purchase at shinybadges.com, write worms in the transaction comments, and I'll send you something weird.
Creamy Radio Audio. Want caviar sound on a cat food budget? Creamy Radio Audio by the Freedom Fiends has great free tips so you can sound like a pro without spending like one. The most powerful form of human communication is one person speaking to another. But if people have to suffer through your sound, they'll change the channel and miss your message. With articles on microphones, preamps, recorders, mastering, recording remotely over the internet, doing a podcast, even getting a show on actual radio, the Freedom Fiends show you what they use and where to get it. Whether you're a talk show host, voiceover artist, podcaster, evangelist, or just want to record your loved ones for the ages, at Creamy Radio Audio, the Freedom Fiends will help you make the most of your sound. Creamy Radio Audio will help you speak to the world with sound that will make people want to keep listening. Check out creamyradioaudio.com. That's creamyradioaudio.com.
Freedom Fiends, this is the distance learning voluntarism school. Do you say voluntarism or voluntarism?
I say voluntarism.
Yeah, because voluntarism sounds too much like volunteerism, which is
like volunteerism. Yeah,
building houses for Habitat for Humanity or something.
I've heard people call it that. Not anybody that's, you know, that's libertarian like us, but you know.
Anyways, it's basically the idea that you know, people shouldn't be able to force you to do things that don't have as long as there's no victim. See, here's the thing: like the hippies, this is another thing the hippies got half right. They said like, do whatever you want as long as it feels good. But they didn't really take into account that a lot of things they did, like being involved in politics, had consequences that harmed people.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
All right. So we're talking about the MOVE organization, the anarcho, what did you call them? Primitivist.
Yeah. They were close to kind of anarcho primitivist. And so they were political, but they were not involved in the political process.
You know, who's anarcho primitivist is the main character in the movie Fight Club. You know, he wants to blow up buildings to destroy the credit card debt as if that would do it. But, you know, and he has this like fantasy of when he's coming out in and out of consciousness after the car crash that I think is this really beautiful poetry. It's something like, you know, you climb the Sears, you climb the kudzu vines, wrap the Sears tower. You look down and see what used to be a 4-lane superhighway. You see people in loincloths pounding corn with rocks, you know, like that's what he wants to go back to. And that movie is not about boxing. That movie's not about boxing. It's about
there's a lot of good things in there.
A lot of good things in there. But yeah, I don't like the violence and I don't like the I like my technologies. I don't want to get rid of them. But so talk about MOVE and what happened when they moved to the second location in the very residential neighborhood where their house was literally connected to other houses. And there were children playing in the street and there were people trying to sleep and go to work.
So they moved to a house and they pretty much kept doing the same thing. They were growing their own food, composting, broadcasting political messages by bullhorn.
But they built
they weren't the best neighbors.
They built a bunker on the roof on this house.
Yes. Yeah. Yes, they built a bunker on the roof, and they were doing community-oriented things, and they ended up getting a lot of the neighbors were complaining, and the police came after them again, and they tried to clear the house out and arrest them, and basically for things like parole violation, contempt of court, illegal possession of firearms, making terrorist threats, which, I mean, back then
all the made up crimes that they use when they don't have something to get someone on.
Right. But this is where things just get so out of control and people don't realize the MOVE organization, I think, gets overlooked a lot when libertarians talk about things like Waco and Ruby Ridge. They brought in so many cops. They closed off the whole block. They started lobbing tear gas canisters.
We're missing some points here. They cleared out. They made all the other residents leave. And then they yelled at the house with a bullhorn and told, like, basically they evicted people from their homes for the day. Actually forever, if you follow this story to the end.
Yeah.
They towed all the cars on the street. They brought in a water cannon and soaked the roof of the house for like 8 hours. Like, basically to a couple reasons. One was because tear gas works better in a damp, you know, humid environment. And another was they were trying to collapse the roof of the house on the people. And they knew there were kids in this house, too. And, you know, another was they just wanted to try to flood them out. And that didn't work. They wouldn't leave. They wouldn't come out. And basically what they did was they dropped a bomb on the roof of this building. They flew over it with a helicopter and they dropped like 4 pounds of C4 with a 45 second fuse on the roof. Now think about that. In America, on American citizens, on American soil, without a trial, and they burned that house to the ground and they burned all the neighbor, like four square blocks to the ground.
65 houses.
Yeah.
Yeah, man. I honestly have never heard of this incident before.
And one of the most evil aspects of this documentary, we're talking about this documentary called Let the Fire Burn. The title of that, it's not a burn baby burn thing. It's something the cop said. There is footage that was filmed by the police from across the street while the house was burning. And one cop says, you know, are they going to put it out? And the other one's like, no, man, let the fire burn. And then the other cop says, well, they'll never call the chief of police an a-hole again or something like that. Like, they're laughing.
Oh my God.
While not only these people they're targeting's houses are burning, but, you know, 65 other houses are burning.
Right.
Yeah.
Five children died in the fire. Five children.
How many adults?
Six adults, including John Africa.
Yeah. Yep.
Yeah, and John Africa was a charismatic leader of the group. Interesting thing about John Africa, he was actually illiterate, but he dictated a book, he would dictate speeches too, and people would write them down. He was still a very good speaker despite being functionally illiterate. So very charismatic. Again, you have this charismatic leader. He has these followers. They all change their surnames to Africa. But they were targeted, and this is essentially them defending themselves. Yes, they were annoying neighbors, but libertarians talk a lot about, oh, well, you know, you have a right to use
you'd have stink insurance.
Violence against the police. Yeah, you got it. You know,
that's actually a thing that that philosopher guy from Canada has said was, oh, well, in a free market, you deal with the neighbors having, you know, human waste as compost by having stink insurance.
Stink insurance.
Yeah.
His John Africa's wife, Ramona, said she's one of the two survivors, said that police actually fired at those trying to escape the house while it was burning down.
Oh, there was a lot of gunplay, and it was mostly blamed. It was blamed on the MOVE members, but a lot of it was automatic fire, and there were no automatic weapons found after. It was all semi-auto. So it was the police just railing him with bullets. They shot back. But, you know, what gun nut wouldn't, or at least claims he wouldn't, you know?
Well, and you don't even have to be a gun nut. This is basic self-defense. If people are using weapons to attack you, you have the right to self-defense. And a lot of people, especially in the power structure, they don't really like that. They, you know, this is why these people were targeted, why the Panthers were targeted, why Malcolm X was targeted, because they were making these very sound self-defense arguments.
You know, there's another thing.
It turns out there was a civil suit. filed and that the jury found that the city used excessive force and violated the members' constitutional protections against unreasonable search and seizures. And Philadelphia was then nicknamed the city that bombed itself.
Yeah. Another thing that I think that current libertarian activists could learn from this whole era is the kind of speeches that these people gave in court. If you look at Let the Fire Burn, there's some place where there's a, I don't even know if it's really a court proceeding. It might be a, you know, a query of the court, but some survivors and family members of this event are being, you know, grilled by the chief of police and some people from the mayor's office. And it's basically, they're not trying to use magic words to get out. You know, they're not trying to like sign their names in all caps. They're basically, they know that no matter what they say, it's not going to help them. So they're giving really eloquent speeches. I mean, it looks like something from a movie, but it's real, you know. And if you're going to be willing to go to jail for your beliefs, you might as well say something that sounds awesome in court.
Right.
Right. And this happened with Angela Davis. If you read some of her transcripts, I mean, they tried to get her. I mean, this is such a ridiculous thing what they tried to get her for. Basically, a gun that allegedly belonged to her was used in a hostage situation. Yeah. That someone else did. The guy ended up being killed, you know, anyway. But they tried to get her on conspiracy charges. I mean, it was the craziest thing. And she ended up not getting convicted, which was, I mean, a pretty big deal. It was a pretty big victory because everything was stacked against her.
That interview that the Swedish guy did of her in prison was amazing. Like her, what she had to say was just incredible. You know, he asked her, was she a violent person or was she for violence? And she talked about, the environment that she grew up in. And, she
grew up in Alabama being scared by Birmingham, the Klan. And she's like, of course, my dad had guns. I learned to shoot a gun when I was 8. So
she was friends with the girls who died in the church bombing. She was neighbors with those girls.
Yeah. So, you know, the thing that a lot of these 60s radicals had that the liberty movement doesn't have, and they're all Marxists, and I hate Marxism. I really, really hate it. I am anti-communist, at least, any kind of forced communism. Like I said, in Libertarian Paradise, you know, there could be the commune down the street that's fenced in and they all share everything and that'd be fine because it wouldn't affect other people. But
exactly,
the idea of Marxism is basically like you have to spread this atheistic religion of everyone should have everyone's stuff. And, you know, it basically is a book that comes along with a crate of AK-47s. That is communism. That's how it was spread. And Russia was pumping those things out. That's why, you know, everyone in the world who's trying to seize a little bit of power is doing it with an AK-47 because Russia flooded the world with those things. And, you know, I've got one. I'm not trying to seize any power. I just think they're good. But so the thing is, like, that is a unifying theme that those people had. And it's like, it's something that it seems heroic and people want to die for it. And it's like, you know, anybody who's a Marxist anywhere in the world is the brother and sister of anybody else who's a Marxist in the world. And it's a sick philosophy, but it really does have a unifying theme. And I would say that, like, you know, the people who are clinging to the idea of the Republic can be saved in America and the Constitution is anything other than, you know, something made up by a bunch of landowning tyrants who wanted to control people and expand the federal government. The people that, I mean, they have that to rally around. They have God and they have the Constitution rally around. Libertarians don't have anything to rally around. And really, I mean, liberty is such an individualistic thing. It really doesn't encourage that kind of groupthink. Right. Now, what do we do with liberty to make it spread when it doesn't have that sense? And it's not an every man for himself thing, but it's kind of a non-collectivist thing, you know? What do we do? What do we got?
Radio.
Okay. Well, in any communist takeover, the first thing they do is seize the media. We've already seized the media, and we're not communists. We've got radio. What do we do next?
Well, I know this is one of those things. It's like, I think you can go back and look at some of these tactics. I think there needs to be, more propaganda even. I mean, let's be real.
Dobby Barker's really good at propaganda.
But when it comes to media, it needs to be consumable though. And here's the kind of a problem with libertarians is liberty.me. It's a great site. And I think the goals are well-intentioned.
Everybody gets their own little platform.
But check this out. What libertarians are not the best at is communicating a message concisely. They write these extremely long screeds that are, you know, 10 or 12 pages. I've been guilty of this myself. I've written really long essays. But like, dude, no one's going to read that except other libertarians. Like, you're preaching to the choir, and we have to move out of this idea of like, we're just going to say these buzzwords and just preach to the choir.
Maybe condense the message to a degree.
Yeah.
I think we're doing that.
Yeah.
On the Freedom Fiends and teaching others.
You're listening to Freedom Fiends with Michael Dean and some of his weird friends. And yes, we're broadcasting this into space.
The central scrutinizer is a Soviet-style Leviathan trying to keep track of all you do. That's why I use a VPN or virtual private network from Bola VPN. Bola VPN is inexpensive, secure, and will allow you to use your computer without leaving a trail. Bola VPN is now also offering torrent seed boxes for safely sharing media with the world. And if you open a support ticket saying you heard about them from the Freedom Fiends, they'll add 3 extra days free. That's Bola VPN at BOLEHVPN.net.
This show survives on donations from fiends like you. We put that money back into our show and Liberty Outreach and donate most our ad space to Liberty organizations that make a difference. We're also a teaching hospital, educating the next generation of Liberty talkers on the skills needed to keep the radio flame of truth burning into the future. Put your money where your heart is and make a donation of any amount to the Freedom Fiends. Please go to freedomfiends.com and click on the spinning coin on any post.
Freedom Fiends.
Yeah.
My name is not important. Only what I say is important. All right, so this is Michael Dean. Enough of that hoodoo mystery stuff. I don't have all the answers. And, you know, people say, well, if you don't like what all these other libertarians are doing, what are your answers? And the thing is, I don't have the answers, but I know what the wrong answers are. And I see a lot of the wrong answers out there. And a lot of the wrong answers are following people as if they are gods, unquestioningly, especially people who have a lot in common with Jim Jones. Like, here's what Jim Jones had. He claimed to have the only answer and no one else had it. I'm seeing that a lot in Liberty. He was a charismatic speaker. He claimed to have the answer for anything on any subject. He also claimed to be God, Jesus, and Allah, which I don't think anyone in Liberty is doing per se.
Yeah.
but he kind of like melded into whatever crowd he was speaking to and kind of gave them what they want. And that's the thing that a lot of libertarian leaders are doing. And the other thing I would say is don't be so concerned with spreading the latest tyranny. We all know cops do horrible things. It happens all the time. But I see a lot of people who are Facebook warriors who literally think they're activists, and most of what they do is repost links of horrible things that the government has done.
Right. Yeah.
It is really libertarianism 101. There's already a million people doing it. I'm not saying hide from that stuff or it shouldn't be spread, but I'm saying there's already a lot of people doing it. I would say make your own media, do some activism, invent something. Think of something, you know, I would say Satoshi Nakamoto is the greatest libertarian ever because he invented Bitcoin, which is really pretty much the only thing we've got that's game changing and is going to ripple down into the future in ways we can't even see yet.
Just the technology behind Bitcoin, the blockchain. I mean, that to me is the biggest thing that Bitcoin brought us.
I would also say don't get so excited. Don't be more excited by spreading tyranny than by spreading good news. And I'm not saying put on a smiley face and pretend the world's great, but I'm saying like, I've noticed this, like, you know, if I've posted a link of like, you know, the police raided this house today and killed somebody and it was horrible. And that gets like 150 shares. And then the same minute I post something like, hey, this guy's invented this really cool technology that allows you to do something on the blockchain that nobody's heard of yet. And that gets 2 shares. Like, try to be more excited and spread more like good news than just bad news, because everyone else is already spreading all the bad news. If you disappear forever, that stuff's still going to happen 24/7. There's not enough people cheering for good things happening in Liberty.
Yeah. Isn't that interesting, right? that people tend to be more motivated by the bad things going on?
Well, and there's a name for all of that, the doom porn, basically.
It's doom porn. Okay.
Well, there's
you get really obsessed with the negativity, and it's counterproductive. So create something useful and beautiful and something that works. Technology is, I think, the best example of what we have. And create something valuable and something useful. Yeah. And don't, I really can't stand sometimes is the kind of black and white thinking of categorizing everyone who disagrees with you as not just disagreeing with you, but evil. Like, this is why you don't hear about the MOVE organization, libertarianism. This is why we don't hear about the Black Panthers, because they're socialist, therefore evil, therefore I don't even care anything about what they've done.
Yeah. And I had never looked at it like that before. Honestly, I'm guilty of that too. I didn't deliberately, shun looking at those types of things, but it just never occurred to me. And now I realize that, their motivations and their grievances, they were valid. It's just that the answers that they sought for those problems were not, viable. And the other thing I thought about too is, we look at all the terrible things happening and we want to fix it. Well, you got to take care of yourself first. You've got to, educate yourself.
Libertarians need to make money too. A lot of them are really, really poor. And, talk about agorism, talk about free market, but end up begging for nickels on the internet. And if you want to send a donation to the Freedom Fiends, go to freedomfiends.com. Nah, if you're poor, keep your money, man. You need it more than
free yourself and create something.
Yeah, create something, man. Make some businesses. Yeah. That was another thing, too, in the 70s, like all the black-owned, the push for black-owned businesses. Like, where's the libertarian-owned businesses? There's a few of them.
Google Black Wall Street.
Black Wall Street. Worms.
Worms.
It's been an excellent, excellent, excellent show, man. I think we should continue this weekend. This is not over.
Yes.
Sounds good to me.
Thanks, y'all.
Thanks.
Worms.
Worms.
Worms. A worm-based economy. There's a business idea. There's enough of them.